ready.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the library and the first gamebrary. What is it called? First gamebrary talk of the fall. And it's really nice to see so many people here. And we're so glad that we have Mary Flanagan to speak tonight. And thanks to Digital Kultur at university that brought her. She's a speaker at the class. There is coffee over there, if somebody hasn't noticed, so you can take some coffee. And Mary, she will introduce herself. And we're also streaming, by the way. We usually stream. So if people have questions, they need a microphone to talk in. So the stream will, so we get it on online. And if there is people like watching out there in the world, you can use the hashtag gamebrary and ask whatever you want. And we will ask Mary here. And she will, yeah. So give a huge applause to Mary.
Thank you. Thank you, Per. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, University of Bergen, for bringing me here. I'm excited to be here and especially be in the library because one of the projects I want to talk about has to do with libraries, so that's kind of cool. So I wanted to name this talk something provocative because there's a lot of current media about games changing the world and games are so awesome, which is great. If you love games, you feel like, finally people are not hating on games. This is great. But then I also want to take a critical perspective and say, well, exactly how are they changing the world and why would they be changing the world? And I wanted to share some research that I've been doing for the past several years. So what I'm going to do tonight is just talk a little bit about a few different projects and some contemporary games at first, and then get into my own research to show what I've been working on and what games have revealed through that project, and then have lots of questions, hopefully. I'm an artist, and I also do a lot of game design. I have two games here. One is called Monarch, which is actually not, this is a print proof. It's not even released yet. So this is a game that is going to be at Essenspiel in a couple of weeks, I guess, in Germany. And then it's being officially released around October 15th in the United States, and we'll soon have a European distribution. And then one called Buffalo, which is around. I have two copies. One, I'm going to leave one in the library so people can try it out here or another time. And there'll be one in the department as well. And that's a game we're going to play a little bit actually during the talk. So I'll keep you up to date. But one of the things so I run a game lab inside a university, and it's a research lab. So I actually get research funding and do big research projects, experimental, controlled psychological studies on people playing games. And that makes it unique, but I also do it making games that actually get to be products. So I take the games all the way to the end. Many times there's a psychological study, and then they throw the experiments, the actual game away, and I actually want to keep my games and make them finished. And so I do all kinds of games. I started as a digital game designer, and then board games have been only for the last 5 years. I've done sports, I designed sports, a role-playing sport, which is actually done for doctors, which is really fun. That's another story. It's like doctors LARPing as people. And then stuff for public health, all kinds of different games. So digital games, apps, board games, card games, sports, lots of different things for the last 15, 20 years, something like that. So let's just think about games in general, starting off the gamebrary series here, about the kind of like distribution of the gaming landscape in relationship to at least other media. And I'm using American examples here, but I'd like to think about something like, you know, Grand Theft Auto 5, which was the most expensive video game ever produced. And think about that in relationship to something like the distribution of something like Candy Crush, which isn't in some, you know, if you're in particular gaming circles, Candy Crush isn't really a game. It's like a, you know, a casual game, and some there's this kind of fight between big games and little games and all kinds of things that I won't get into. But it's quite interesting to see the distribution, and you know, in the United States, Game of Thrones has been really big, but in fact, in the media landscape, in terms of number of people really accessing that media, it's not that large considering we have other kinds of projects. Hunger Games being very influential, and Kim Kardashian Hollywood, theoretically not as influential in terms of the numbers of players. For a while in the United States in 2014, there were more people playing Candy Crush Saga, well, not in the United States, and globally, there are more people playing Candy Crush Saga than living in Australia for many months of 2014 into 2015. So you think about the scale of that, something like 24.7 million downloads is a lot of downloads for one game to have in the world. So these are interesting kinds of facts, and I'm also curious about revenue, because how games make money is also part of why they're created and who creates them, and that's a little bit of a story here that I just want to contextualize some of that. Again, Grand Theft Auto may be the most expensive game to make, but it also has brought in the most revenue, so that's quite interesting, where you have other models here, such as Candy Crush has generated over $2.1 billion, and only 4% of the players spend money in the game. So that's pretty interesting when you're trying to think about, you know, how, you know, $850,000 per day. Many games that are making are hits, such as Candy Crush, make about $1 million to $2 million a day, and that's pretty wild. So Kim Kardashian's game, on the other hand, last year was making about $700,000 a day. So that's actually, you know, $486 a minute. It's just like $8.10 every second. So anyway, So there's a kind of scale to games' influence that it's really pretty rich in terms of thinking about popularity, thinking about things like social issues. Well, if we can do this in entertainment, what's the barrier between using games for entertainment and using games to address social issues? Even if you know, many nonprofit or international organizations for pro-social causes had, you know, one thousandth of the revenue of any of these games or the distribution of any of these games, we'd have a massive social movement by comparison. And that's been the thinking behind a lot of what we call the Games for Change movement. There have been some pretty amazing games made for the last 10 years, from a game that's called Spent in the United States, which models, basically it gives you choices and it models how quickly someone can become homeless. And it was created, the life choices are so difficult you end up, the likelihood is that you could become homeless. Darfur is Dying was a famous Games for Change game from way back in 2006, and you are a Sudanese refugee trying to survive in a refugee camp. So there's lots of these, and some of them are in the sciences. I have a little screenshot down here of a game called Fold It, and that one you may have heard of, which is a game where scientists were trying to use massive numbers of players to do collective problem solving to model how a particular protein was folding, and that protein folding is instrumental in treating HIV and trying to come up with an HIV prevention or vaccination. So all of these kinds of games are doing some amazing things, and they're really trying to do that. They're trying to raise discussion and awareness, but, you know, I think they're also trying to do more than that. I think they're actually trying to enact change, right? But here's this interesting question. So there are many aims, you know, in other sectors of society, like food industries. You know, this bread is nutritious, or this ketchup has this much protein. Actually, this ketchup has no protein, really. It's like, but we have other ways of measuring kind of experiences in the world. We have ways of measuring food. We have fewer experiences of measuring art, and I think that that's an okay thing. I don't think every single thing in the world has to be measured. But when game makers are trying to enact a specific outcome, I think we have a question of, okay, well, how do we measure that? How do we know what's happening? And can damage be done? If we don't know what we're doing, we try to have an intention of doing something that's positive and social, and you end up not having a positive and social effect. And one example of these kinds of social programs that are problematic are different psychological programs. Like, for example, in the United States, after 9/11, when the firefighters were fighting and losing all of their friends, and there was a kind of bad situation in Manhattan, The common practice, and this is not that long ago, the common practice was to take the firefighters and have them go through post-traumatic stress syndrome, PTSD, training by reliving the event and kind of working through it very vividly. And shortly thereafter, many psychologists said, whoa, that's not actually how you treat this kind of thing. We have data that suggests that that will actually cause that trauma. So there's a lot. There are many programs. We have in the United States a program called Dare to Keep Your Kids Off Drugs. So they have this training about kids should not have drugs, and it increases people's drug use who go through this program. So there are lots of social programs that we actually have very little understanding about. And when we kind of adopt these assumptions into games, and make games completely instrumental in some aim, I think we have to be, A, very careful to do that, because games are an art form and there are many moving parts, and then B, you know, how do you prove that this is happening, and where's the evidence, and do we believe it, right? Because that's the important stuff. So I want to just share with you a few popular studies going on. Probably many of you have seen or heard of this game called Tetris from 1980 originally. In 2009, researchers found that Tetris can grow your brain. MRI results on players who were non-gaming girls who learned, they had never played Tetris before, and then they learned how to play Tetris and they went through MRI studies, actually showed greater efficiency consistent with earlier studies, they showed some interesting play patterns. Of course, they got better and better and better as they played, but they also developed a thicker brain cortex, so their brain actually changed through the course of the study. And their areas of the brain where neuroscientists think that efficiency occurs. So this is kind of an interesting thing. Your brain is growing when you play Tetris. You know, I hope it's growing in the right way. I hope it's not growing in some way I don't want it to grow. Super Mario was studied quite a bit for this. And in 2014, some researchers found that adults who played Super Mario for 30 minutes a day for 2 months, okay, so set yourself up for this, also grew gray matter compared to people who didn't play. So they were growing brain cells and gray matter, and the team noted that the hippocampus growth matched how participants reported changes from an egocentric understanding of space, so space in relationship to me, oh, I'm going to turn left, I'm going to turn right, the egocentric, versus an allocentric, so objects in relation to each other without reference to one's body. Oh, that's the room is to the left of the other room. So different spatial reasoning actually was reported by the players, and then and that's funny because it's a 2D game. It's a two-dimensional game. No one really knows why this is. So the next step, of course, would be to figure out, well, what games don't grow your brain cells, and how do you measure those things in between each other? So not only may your brain literally grow when playing a game, but improving in a game helps one's overall happiness. And this has been shown. A passion for games in itself can be positive. So in the Super Mario study, people who were the most excited to play Super Mario exhibited the most brain growth. So people are just like, yes, I can't wait. They actually, their brains were actually growing. We don't really know the true implications of this. Neuroscience sometimes just teases us to think about things, and we don't always know all of the causes and effects. But I think these are provocative inroads to thinking about the complexity of this type of media. And there are downsides in certain studies as well. So for example, many people tout games as being like this kind of helping the mind multitask. I mean, we all, I think, especially now that most of us are stuck on phones for a good part of the day, right? I think that we can multitask really well. And Clifford Nass thought that people assume this as well. And it's quite interesting. So from the 1970s, two studies as of last year, probably early this year, I haven't seen a study from this early this year, but it takes forever to get studies out. There have been consistent studies to show that multitasking actually is not improving in most people. Even though we see, oh, well, you know, our generation grew up with computers, we're better at it. Actually, people who multitask tend to be poorer performers at all tasks. Oops. And there's also some interesting things, like in a recent study using laptops in college classrooms, researchers found that those who multitask during lectures scored lower on tests compared to those who didn't. But they found that multitasking was detrimental to the person sitting next to them. So if I'm multitasking and lowering my grade, the person next to me is kind of a zone of distraction. The person next to me also has lowered grades. If somebody assigned seats in lecture hall and tried to monitor people's grades versus another control classroom. So it's like multitasking is a contagion. I don't know if you've ever like walked into a room and you're kind of awkward and you see someone else with the phone, you kind of pull out your, like it's a contagion thing, which is really interesting. So again, we're not going to all put down our phones because it's like, oh, we're terrible at multitasking. But I think we might want to know which, you know, maybe I better not think about this problem while I'm multitasking. And a final kind of general overview. I mean, there are many, 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 many studies, and I could go on. I even have a book manuscript, so maybe I should just have put all the examples in that because there are many, many studies. But I want to share one more interesting example, which was a study that my student did at Dartmouth College in the United States, which is based on a game called Blockus. I don't know if you've ever seen this board game. It's a board game. But the board game, it's touted, it has all these awards, that's the box up in the corner, and it has all of these awards. It won a Mensa Award, which is really like a intelligent society. It won learning awards and educational awards. But no one has actually really published studies on what it teaches or what it is good at. So my student set up a big experimental study where she varied conditions between she had pairs of players play for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks. It actually took like maybe 6 to 8 months to do this study. And she set players up in pairs of two, and they didn't know each other. The players never knew each other. And they would play a game of Blockus and then complete spatial reasoning tests like you would have on a standardized test, like, oh, here are these blocks, and you have to rotate them, and then you answer questions like in these tests. And when she introduced the game as, here, just play a game, have fun, play this game, and then did the test afterwards, this is male and female participants scored about the same on those spatial reasoning tests. But the one group where she said, play this game, it's a strategic game, men's scores went up and women's scores went down, and they're playing the same game. The box, by the way, says a strategy game for the whole family. So this is probably if people read that, they're framing, they have a psychological frame, and that's probably the result that families would get, for example. And when the game was introduced as a spatial game, the performance for women went way down, and the performance for men went up. So you see these very and it's the same game, same setup, same exact wording on everything else but those words. So that makes you maybe think a little bit about the way that setting up a game experience or playing a game experience, how malleable it is, and how interesting it is to when we even introduce things, or as educators, what kinds of frames do we set up when we even begin a task? And it makes it specifically interesting when game designers are increasingly involving groups of gambling consultants and people to continue to keep people
you know, very much engaged, to keep people feeling need, to keep people on track. You know, behavioral experts from casino design are actually coming into game design, and then that could be really great if you're thinking about getting everyone, addicted to, you know, chemistry experiments. But it may not necessarily be good in other situations. So, but this talk tonight is also about games having influence and how you could choose to have influence. I mean, so knowing all that stuff, I'm like, okay, wow, this is pretty amazing. What can I do as a designer? Like, what am I making? And what can I study to see if I'm getting the right results? So I'm going to talk about the experience of working on three different games. The first is this game Monarch here, this new board game that explores character representation. The studies I did were on character representation. The second is a party game, Buffalo, that's been played in the audience, and I'm going to play a little bit with you all. And then the third is a digital app that collects new knowledge for libraries and archives. So let me tell you a little bit about Monarch. In Monarch, you see the box there. It's a little bit different now. I didn't like the... Anyway. So in Monarch, the idea was to create a kind of Settlers of Catan-esque German-style board game. And I'm saying this in a very loose category. If you're a really hardcore gamer, I will talk to you about its set building and not its resource management. But whatever. In this game, you play as sisters vying for the throne. Your mother, the queen, is dying, and you play as sisters to see who's going to be the next ruler. So you have to rule the lands well, you have to build up a glorious court, and then someone may win. One of you becomes the next queen. And there are these different strategies to choose from. So I'm going to show you some charts. I hope that's not too charty for an after work kind of after a long day. I thought it'd be good to just show you data, though, because I can explain it, and if you don't get it, we'll go over it later. But I did several different studies on this game, and in one study, my team studied the full prototype where we told we actually did studies in men's boarding schools, so male students between the ages of 13 and 17 years old. So adolescent boys, men. And players were told right out in one group that they were playing as princesses. And they're going to play as sisters, they play as princesses, and they play the game. And another group was not told that. They were just playing the game. And then halfway through gameplay, about 13 cards in, actually, somebody pulls a card and it says, your sisters, da 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 da. Give your sister something. And at that moment, everyone stops the game in this particular condition, looks at each other, and they're like, I'm not your sister. I'm not your sister. Who are you? I'm not a girl. And the whole game has a meltdown. And it happens every time. And this and that with that age group, it happened every time. And I was like, oh, you know, I'm way in the back, they can't see me, but I was like, oh, no, this is horrible, because the other game, the people were just playing along, and I thought, oh, it's kind of going, you know, they didn't really fight about this group, oh, and it happened time after time of rounds of play again and again. Interestingly, the team with the players who played in the meltdown condition actually... which is the delay reveal. They found out halfway through that they were playing as sisters. They actually saw that the game was more rewarding, worth playing again. They said it was less appropriate for girls. Just these very strange things. And they also, in a psychological test of experience taking, which is how deeply you can kind of connect and see something from someone else's point of view, they were much higher in the scores. So that's interesting, that actually breaking the game, I thought it was, I really thought that was a bad move. It actually helped not make things so obvious for the players and made a different experience. So it was very interesting. The other part of this was the measure we used, I thought would interest some of the people in the audience tonight, because we actually used a measure which presents a set of 10 sentences identified as the first line of a story, a work of fiction. And each one begins with an individual whose name is gender ambiguous. And then the players in the analysis after playing have to write out the rest of the story. So we said the tears ran down Arlu's face. And no one knows if Arlu's male or female. And they were instructed to imagine that this is the first line of a short story, now write the second line. So it was a pronoun study. Do people talk about men? People talk about women, females? There were no differences in the neutral condition, but in the delayed reveal, it was really interesting that the people in the study wrote more female, like her. They kind of assumed the characters were women, and they changed how they thought about characters and stories. So that this study was important for several reasons. It demonstrated that a little ambiguity for players goes a long way in helping them identify with and connect with new play experiences and new perspectives. We also did a study on maybe overtly stereotypical looking female characters versus more androgynous female characters, and had similar kinds of results. So that's just something that fed into the development of this game. So now we're going to play a little Buffalo. Okay, we need a break. So to play, you have to name a person, fictional or real, living or dead, who matches the criteria on two cards. So you'll see what I mean. And you have to shout it out. Just shout it out. If it's a Norwegian person that I might not know, we will have a group jury decide. Actually, it's a group juried game. That's how it works. Male scientist. Stephen Hawking. I heard Stephen Hawking first. Okay, in a smaller group, like 10 people, you could figure out who said it first. But you would get these points as cards. Okay, Stephen Hawking and Einstein. All right, ready? Shelley Jackson. I'm not sure everyone in the room knows Shelley Jackson. She did a project about tattoos, though. She did a novel. Yeah, she probably has tattoos. I don't know if you're going to get that, especially because you got the last one. Woohoo? Like Mad Max? No? Like, no one? You're allowed to, that's the whole game. Yeah. Okay, yeah. All right, nobody knows. All right, well, in this case, we would be buffaloed. We'd have to put two more cards out, and then you can begin to mix and match until you get rid of the cards that you don't know. How about this one? I'm dope. Excuse me. No one agrees with him, or you just... We're brainstorming now. I think you get it, but I... We're in the comic section over here. This makes me feel very warm inside. Yes. The new Miss Marvel. Okay. Yes. Not mixed. I had some people talk about Wolverine, but then it was a question of mixed species. I don't know. It depends on the group. It might fly, but I don't know. Marie Curie, Ada Lovelace. Marie Curie is generally the number one global named woman scientist, but we had three different ones in this room, which is maybe a first. That was awesome. All right, so you see what Buffalo is kind of doing. So. It's a party game. It works really well in pubs. It works in family night, family games. It works with a bunch of friends, and you gather points by the number of cards that you gather. But it's also doing some interesting pro-social stuff along the side. So one of the things I do in my research lab is really try to figure out how to how to address biases and stereotypes, cultural biases and cultural stereotypes, and mostly in a UX context, although I think a game like this might translate majority of the cards into other contexts as well. So the design and strategy for this game is a clear departure from games, the kind of games for change. It's not saying, oh, here's a social issue. It's not like a documentary. It's not trying to do things, I'm gonna educate you about something. It's just a game, but it actually, through playing the game, causes some interesting collisions. And so this is part of a series of bias-related or social bias-related board games that I was working on, board games and card games that I was working on. And it's really interesting. So I want to show you some of the data. When we did tests with Buffalo, we used two tests that social scientists use to measure bias, specifically racial bias, but they can be used for any kind of bias. The average social identity complexity scale and the average universal orientation scale. So when you ask, how do you actually measure racism? Well, psychologists have been doing this for a while, measuring different kinds of, they measure all kinds of things, and you can gather these. And I happen to have, for the last 4 years, have social psychologists who work in my lab who can bring this really detailed expertise. Since I'm not trained as a social scientist, I'm originally an artist, so I've learned a lot about how to conduct an experiment and how to not bias your participants, etc. So what's happening here is these changes are statistically significant changes. When the game raises average social identity complexity, it actually is expanding the way that we characterize other people. So if I had a low social identity complexity, I might like, oh, all artists wear black. Oh, all people who play sports don't get good grades. Oh, or whatever the stereotypes, you might jump to them really fast. But when you have an expanded social identity complex, you might not make those judgments so quick. You might say, oh, well, I know an artist who wears a lot of colors, or I know an artist who likes to play tennis. And so you make more complex that social identity. And that's basically how the game is functioning. By giving you surprises, it actually starts unwinding or unworking some of those differences. And I just want to share some funny tweets about this. There was a really strange one. Played a demo of Tiltfactor's Buffalo, most awesome game I've ever played, about what a terrible person I am. This is before Cards Against Humanity came out, and this is, and this idea that people are reflecting upon, oh, I should have gotten that, oh, you know, there's this kind of conscious level, you know, so there's this conscious level where people are working and trying to come up with answers, but there's an unconscious activity too, which is by having these counter-stereotypical examples. And then, yeah, people were just talking about how shameful it was. But according to Harvard researchers who work on injustice for many, many years, and a lot of other researchers have talked about, okay, teaching people about discrimination or asking people to be empathetic, so far in the data, has not really worked. And Mazreen Banaji says that what works, at least temporarily, you know, for at least a 24-hour period, is counter-stereotypical message. A counter-stereotypical message, and that's what Buffalo creates nonstop. It's an algorithm, in a way, for counter-stereotypical messages. You might get one stereotypical thing and everyone laughs about it, but the things you really struggle with are actually working new, possibly new pathways in the mind. And some of these counter, it's not intuitive, right? It's not intuitive that playing a game where you're just kind of naming people and you have to think fast would actually be like undoing something. You would think it'd be redoing something. And I just wanted to share really quickly another study where I was really surprised by something, which was that I was doing a game about vaccination. And my team and I originally made this game called Pox. It was a board game. Then we made a digital iPad version of the game Pox. And basically, it's about disease spread. It's an abstract, the red things are disease, and they spread through the board. And you're trying to contain disease by vaccinating people who are in here are blue, right? Well, we did an experimental study, and we actually had basically, I took it to a toy and game fair, and they're like, if it was about zombies, we'd really like this game. And so we made a zombie version of the game, but then we made a stripped-down one, so it's not as colorful as the one we actually produced for the mass audience, but this one was very close. It had to be somewhat close in terms of art style and tone so that we could study the differences. We played this just like I was mentioning the other study. We had groups of two play the game, either an iPad between them or a board game, one of these three games, and it was really, again, very interesting. We found that when people were asked about their subjective value of vaccination, how they thought vaccination was important, and we also measured systems thinking, how they understood systemic decisions, both of these, the zombie version actually was by far, with the board game, more effective than the digital version of the game or a control version of the game. Which wasn't our game. They just played a game and then had the access. So it's just this idea that sometimes, we don't have mass health campaigns where people talk about zombies, right? I mean, that would, but my research, I mean, it sounds a little, out there, but my research suggests that would be effective. That high school chemistry class or secondary school math class, might actually benefit from introduction of fiction into those areas for more engagement. All right, so they also, that we did a follow-up study and they, the players of the non-digital games actually spoke to each other a lot more, and they also lost more games. The digital people actually played much faster and spoke to each other less, which was also very interesting, which led to a whole other set of studies that I'm not going to talk about, but fascinating. Okay, the final set of games I'm going to talk about, this will be brief, are games. This is a totally different kind of project in terms of social engagement or pro-social stuff. And this is where we are making games that use the power of getting a lot of people's input to augment library and archive holdings. And so, for example, here you see that people are, you see people typing. We ask people how to type something. We ask for a 4-letter word, a 5-letter word, and it's basically to get tags on media that exists in libraries and archives for which we don't know that much about. So I'm working with this group. I'll try to explain this a little more when you see the game video. I'm working with a group called the Bioheritage Diversity Library, and they document plant species hundreds and hundreds of years all around the world. They're like the brain of plants. And so they have manuscripts and ancient books and field notebooks and handwritten documents by scientists from the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s. And here's what some of them look like. You see the handwritten manuscripts. Now, when you try to run this through a scanner and get automatic character recognition, it's not doing so well. This is what that translates to. Sometimes some of them do better than that. But when some of them are somewhat close, but there are a lot of errors. And so what we did, my team and I decided to make a game that helps correct errors so that there are better error correction technologies. So I'll show you how this works. Oh yeah, we have like our zany music. So you have this team of players. These robots are attacking. You have to type the words to send different players to attack your robots. So this is like male, vegeto. You don't have to put in accents, which is awesome. And right now this is only in English, but it could be adapted. So, and then there are many, many levels and people are playing it. And every one of those words that are typed goes in to correct that garbage OCR database. And so people can search for historic plant records. Anyway, there you go. The robots are beaten senselessly by this insensitive team. So again, here's how that works. So it makes these historical books searchable. You have historical documents. It pulls the words out. It's actually, it scans the text and then breaks every word up into its own JPEG, and then we can actually match the word back to the picture again. So that's just one project. When we can actually take a game and do something really pro-social with it. And players compared it to typing. This is at the Boston Festival of Independent Games the weekend before last. Players compared it to a game called Typing of the Dead or a typing game. They all thought it was a typing game. They thought they were improving their typing scores, and they were trying to beat each other and do this stuff. And interestingly, it just won Best Serious Game at the Independent Games Festival in Boston, which I was surprised. I was surprised at. So we had it there in the Boston Festival for one day, and it generated 10,000 matches for the archives. So that's a lot of data. So just to wrap up, so gaming projects for cultural purposes in this broad spectrum of things that I've been talking about tonight lead to a variety of like theoretical and socially relevant questions. Janet Murray, a scholar of games at Georgia Institute of Technology, has noted, games give us a chance to enact our most basic relationship to the world, our desire to prevail over adversity, to survive our inevitable defeats, to shape our environment, to master complexity, and to make our lives fit together like the pieces of a jigsaw puzzle. Games are a form of enactment. They provide a space for systems of being and thinking to happen. So I hope by looking at these games and what they can do from an instrumental, practical perspective, we don't lose sight, however, that games have occupied a space about being human for 8,000 years. You know, we have game artifacts, board game artifacts that go back to 6500 BC in Jordan. Games were probably played before that without objects or with more ephemeral objects. So games are really a part of human practice and even animal practice. They're ancient. So I don't want to mistake something I think is a pretty profound medium and make it purely instrumental. But I do think that many, many, many games are doing interesting things, and we should really know more about what they're doing. So I hope my brief talk here today has inspired you to take a close look at the games you love and read this volumes of scientific research on what they may do, because they're all doing many things, and we enact and become within them. The latest research just gives us a little bit of the totality, and it's an exciting look on an ancient practice. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for listening. And we have a little time we probably have a lot of time for questions. I know I put a lot of data at you, but we can take a moment and stretch it out. So thank you very much for your attention.
Hi there. I have a few questions, if that's all right.
We may have to cycle, depends on how long they go.
Yeah, sure. Smorballing, was that the name of the last game?
Yes.
What was the base correctness values based on, as you're doing research to actually decipher these? So what's the base context to which you say this is the correct typing?
There are several ways we figure out how, I mean, this. It's funny to make games that try to get an answer when there's no answer. Right? It's not like you can check it against a list. So basically, we look at a variety of things. We look at, we can match to dictionaries. We can match to, we have a particular algorithm that looks at English words and how they come together. So BR is a common combination, and BZ is not a common combination. So we have a probability index for those kinds of things. And then we also have thousands of input, so we can look at them through time.
Okay, a small follow-up on that then. would, for instance, a word given the first time be able to have two different correct results? And
two, perhaps, but probably not 20 or 30.
Okay. Yeah. And then you would compile the results to.
Yeah, we look at results over time. Yeah, we don't put them back into the database right away.
Okay.
We also have a lot of stop words and other kinds of tricks.
I'll cut out one question because of the follow-up. Back at Monarch,
yes.
You had the pronouns section.
Yes, the pronoun study.
Yeah, I was wondering if the result might be because of the ones who knew the entire time that they were playing as sisters might then assign the opposite gender more frequently to their character they're playing, while the ones who didn't know are more open to interpretation on the specific name.
Yes, anytime there's a study, often participants can, sometimes players and participants can figure out what the study's about, right? And there is a danger of giving researchers what they want to hear. That's why when we design the questions, there are other questions built in that completely distract from that kind of thing. So it's not like, oh, here I am, now they're asking me about gender, and I can just answer. We asked about all kinds of things, about modeling castles, and about. So I'm showing you the stuff that mattered, but we put a lot of other kinds of questions in so that our intentions are mixed in.
Okay.
It's a common problem with psychological research. This is why you get a psychologist to help make sure it's really as close as you can. I mean, nothing in the world is pure, but hopefully you can get very, very. You have to be very cautious.
Thanks.
Sure. Thanks for your questions. Those are good. High standard. Hello. Oh. Huh? Wait. When you'll be next?
Yeah. Considering you've been developing both electronical or digital and
paper
analog games, would you say there is a big discrepancy between results with the two? I mean, digital as opposed to analog games, do you get different results from them?
Well, I've only done one study about that, and that was this one. It's really slow.
Yeah,
the POX. It's the only, and there are very few studies of the same game, analog and digital. It's just not that interesting to a lot of researchers. In fact, in the United States, saying we're going to solve a problem with a board game is a very unhip thing to say. Right? Because it's like, oh, that's not new, it's not technology, technology can solve everything. Certainly you should solve all of your problems with technology. So this was actually funded by a local group who didn't want to give brochures, like packets of paper. They're like, oh, maybe this is, So the follow-up studies to this were more reading studies about reading text. But it's quite interesting because this watching people play led to the other research questions. You know, when people played these two are the analog games. This is the digital game. And when people played this, they played so much faster, and they didn't talk much, and they pressed the buttons, and then they lost a lot. They lost 5 out of 6 times. The players of the analog won 5 out of 6 times. So it was really interesting. People, the iPad is not a medium of deep reflection and thoughtfulness, one could argue, unless you build it in. But there are affordances to every material medium that we maybe haven't really digested. That's my thought. I'm not saying that all iPads make you work fast, but there may be a trend that we haven't identified because very few people study that question. Hello.
Thanks very much for your talk, Mary. I want to congratulate you on not tripping over the cord, even though I saw you didn't look down at the floor once.
Oh.
Quite an achievement.
Just lift.
Yeah. I have a question about the brain changes that you talked about initially. Were they volume increases, or was it number of cells, or was it number of connections?
It's density, and I think it's
cell density.
Cell density, yeah. Okay. Yeah. I should send you these. I mean, it's really...
So in that case, it would be number of cells.
Yeah.
If it's density. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So there they are, just doing something up there.
I just wanted to ask about the, to come back to the, I think the board game and digital game question is really interesting, but the other aspect of it that you highlighted was the conversations afterwards, that there was more dialogue?
During, yeah.
Or during?
Mm-hmm. Just say individualistic, maybe, or connected in a different way.
Yeah. I guess I'm just thinking about what other sorts.
I mean, I would love to have a research team of 50 people and run studies on all of, tons of different combinations of different experiences and see if what we could find out, because that would be awesome. But I don't know, but I do know that I've speculated, is it the act of picking up, is it really a tactile thing? Is it something about habit of the use of the object, is it really an analog digital divide or a cultural practice question, which is, okay, iPads, you're used to just flicking around and not necessarily investing and looking up something fast. Is it that? Or is it something like, I'm picking up a tangible thing and there's a large part of me that is built to think about something when I don't know.
At sort of promoting that kind of discussion.
Well, certainly the card games, it was kind of an accident that they ended up being card games. They were just, they were something that I could produce and get into more schools, because I couldn't figure out what platform could get into schools, especially for this game Awkward Moment. And the teachers really didn't know when they would use it and all of this. And when there's an object, they figure out where it goes. And they play this. Here's something you do for 4 minutes or 5 minutes. So there was some of it is kind of cultural or habit, but also there's some other. I had a business student once working with me at one of the game booths at one of the trade shows. He's like, okay, when you're working the booth, he's like, anytime someone stops by, give them something. And then they'll stay around. And I was like, really? And he's like, yeah, the active exchange makes people kind of have this subconscious. I was like, what do they teach you in business school? Like, what? Like, is that what you're talking about? Like, that's so strange. So we started giving out raffle tickets, and people, and I was like, this is ridiculous. Are you kidding me, raffle ticket? And then totally, people stuck around and had interesting conversations, and it was this weird token of exchange. So I don't have any science on that at all. I have no idea. But it seemed to kind of be interesting. So there, human interaction, the most frustrating and fascinating thing is that each discipline from an academic perspective has a totally different body of knowledge about human interaction, right? So the psychologists are over here looking at, discrimination from this point of view, and or discussion or attention. And these people in the business school are looking at attention from a very different, and the casino people are looking at attention from a very different. And all of these people have knowledges that are kind of circulating in different aspects. And so one of the reasons my work ends up being so interdisciplinary and why I'm science and just all over is because I'm trying to pull together at least some of it in certain pockets. Because it is fascinating though. But certainly we didn't, something about using the iPad was peculiar. And then we did a reading study after this that, I don't know, is it published? Is it under review? I don't know. I don't know where it is. I can't talk too much about that, I guess, but it did look at reading different kinds of material that would be cognitively different kinds of cognitive tasks through digital and analog technology with contemporary college students right now who all have iPads and grew up with digital technology.
And we found similar trends that there was like for kind of denser reading, people reading on the iPad didn't really respond in the same level that people in the paper version did. So,
We have a question from the internet, from Herdis.
Like to say it's from the internet.
Yes. Do you have any impressions of the game industry in Bergen locally?
Only that some of the members of the game industry are here in this room, which is awesome. But they have not asked a question, so I don't know what their perspective is on all this. Certainly I think that there's a growing identity here on the technology and game sphere, so that's very cool. And there's several big festivals, even with analog games as well, right? Like there's several board game festivals or, you know, kind of that kind of thing. So I think it's vibrant. What do you think? Vibrant?
Ask Lynn.
Lynn?
Yeah. It's very vibrant.
I thought it was vibrant. Lynn knows.
Am I sorry? Should I talk about the Norwegian game industry for a while? there's a lot happening. I mean, as well, you know, because of the independent game movement, you see a lot of Norwegian game developers coming out, and we've also in Norway been very good at our governmental funding towards game has come from the arts. So it's been very focused on being as the game developers get to be as creative as they want to be without having to think about sales.
Considered culture, not business necessarily.
Yeah. So we see a lot of great innovation within games from the Norwegian game industry. It just needs a little bit more polish and a little bit more commercialization, and we'll get the money at least. But yeah, we have, I think Sylvia knows this better than me. How many game developers do we have in Norway now? 107 game studios in Norway.
Wow.
And in Bergen, we have a great community, very much thanks to the library as well, which we love. We love gamebrary. We love this. Yeah.
That is cool.
But I have a question as well. But am I cutting in line for somebody else? Yeah. I found it very extremely interesting that you won the independent game developing prize for the best game, was it?
Best serious game.
Best serious game. Oh, okay.
Best serious game. But wow. Also Monarch's up for, is a finalist at Indicate, too.
Yay.
Anyway,
I was so excited. I was just wondering about, because there is that sort of stigma to serious games.
There is.
Yeah. And I love the way that your games are very commercialized, can I put it that way? They attract gamers in a way. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that commercialization aspect of it. Basically.
Oh, it's super intentional, right? So it's one of the things I decided to do was try to make games first. And this is not, it took me a while to get here. I mean, I've made other games that were more like, oh, here's a game about genetically modified seeds, and you have to keep them away from your other seeds. And, you know, cute, but more obvious. And all the research that I have been doing myself and reading, not about serious games per se, but in psychology, have suggested that that doesn't do anything. So I thought, well, that's just a waste of everyone's time. Even if I feel good about making something feel good, no one else feels good. So that's just bad. That's just now it's bad. So I completely changed what I wanted to do. And I said, if you had told me like 10 years ago I'd be making paper party games that were like competing with Bananagrams, like this is not what I thought I would do ever, ever, ever in my life. That's, yes, I have played these kind of games growing up. I've always played games like this, and I like playing these games, but I just never, it was not my aspiration. So another interesting thing about this journey has been to make games that actually work, not make my own pet project. Well, this is my own pet project, actually. This is totally my pet project. But these were not my pet. These were really research-driven, but they had to be good designs. And so that it was constantly a struggle to make it. The first version of Buffalo, you're going to love this, it was horrible. It was really bad. It was so bad. you have a card like male, and then it was like chemist, and female engineer. You know, it was one of those games, right? And you're like, oh wow, I will never play this. No one I know would ever play this. This is really bad. This is just bad. And you know, someone's gonna probably make that, but I don't want to make that. And so I just said, like, it has. And so then we actually developed some kind of techniques for getting messages in and having it work, so that so I have a lot of things like that, like instructions on how to, because everything's influencing us, so it's just kind of taking responsibility for how that influence works. It took a while to get to that space, but now those all of these games, especially the paper ones, but even Smoreball is like a typing game, doesn't feel like a social issues game, so people will play it. It's so interesting. We didn't even say that, by the way. We didn't even position it to the players as any kind of game except a game, and they thought it was a typing game, and they named it that. So now we have a typing game, even though it's not a typing game. And this, you know, all of these games are sold commercially, and I just got a distributor for Monarch, and I've been individually selling those out of my own. I'm kind of self-published. I got a warehouse. I mean, the whole truck, you know. It became a thing. Like, it was a bigger commitment than I had originally thought, but it worked, and it sold. I think Buffalo and Awkward Moment have both been out for a couple of years, and so they've all sold over 10,000 copies, which in board game world is pretty high, actually. In the digital game world, it's like ha, but in the board game world, that in the United States, that I was told at Toy Fair that puts us in the top 20% of board game sales in the United States. I was like, well. Good God, what is everyone else selling? So, and I can only hope for, you know, whatever. But they do work as regular games, and that's important. And so that, I think you'll probably see more of that, because people, hopefully, if not, we should all just be very sad. Because it's really, you know, these issues, occasionally the issues games work for certain purposes. Like, I think the game Spent that I mentioned, that has the thing about homelessness, actually does go, it was funded by possibly a community or a church or something. And it actually does, it's very lightweight, it's very small, it's probably inexpensive and yet polished, and it is a thought-provoking tool. But it's not trying to promise, you know, the world, and it is fairly obvious about what it does. But I think in that case, its simplicity also helps it be a little bit, and it is a little bit more slick than some of the other games. But so I think you identified an interesting and hard question in this whole area. But I think Games for Change games have tended to be more like documentary. Let's tell this story, and that's not what games do, you know, that well. Yeah, thank you for that question. Oh,
I think Lynn asked part of my question already. Uh-oh. So I'll just extend my question. If you hadn't guessed, would have been about Games of Change.
Oh,
I'm just going to extend it, because what I see with your Buffalo, for instance, it's almost developing a design for change, and I'm wondering about how. And I'm just throwing this out there for anyone who wants to interact with it, but more slow. Because from, as you know, as I told you, I'm looking at Philanthropy 2.0, and a lot of what features is serious games, and they're automatically connected to how much can you donate for charity, right? Which is just very flat, and the potential of digitality is just taken away from it by making it very flat and interactive, and in fact mystifying. The other, so to speak, but with what you're doing with Buffalo, it's almost like there's a design to change the way you think, and I was wondering if you would ever consider implementing that design in a broader way, or taking it in different ways, because for me, it's not about analog versus digital, because I think analog interaction actually gets more change sometimes, and then you combine it with digital. The reason digital is there is to make it quick and easy for ICT, information communication for development people to work with it. But I was wondering what comments you had.
Yeah, you have mapped my journey.
Oh, okay.
Because I, we have this paper coming out September 30th, which is what, next week, or I don't know. Now, I don't know where I am. Psychologically embedded approach to designing games for pro-social change. So I'm trying to make this into a kind of set of methodologies because I realize that it's great if I can do it, but like that's not really helpful to anyone else. It's like, oh, those games work, and oh, nice. But how could you think about whatever you're working on with these kinds of constraints? I'm very interested in that. So yes, I think it's trying to do that. But I think we're actually going to see more of a certain kind of game making, which is, because the buzzword that I keep being addressed with in emails and whatever is empathy. We're generating empathy. This will generate empathy. So somehow generating empathy has now solved some problem, which is, I don't know if that's really the problem. And I did write a paper about empathy that gets cited now quite a bit, and it was on my journey to getting to this point. So I was like, so maybe we're all kind of, okay, empathy, oh, no, empathy doesn't work. How about new models? Oh, maybe new models work. So maybe we're all kind of, inching along towards a more interesting thing. But, for everyone doing, kind of trying to understand pro-social design, you still have a lot of people, including advertising, which is known for quite a long period of time how to manipulate people's thoughts and feelings to get them to do certain things. I mean, it's not like this is, the only kind of intentionality in media that exists. And that's interesting. I mean, when you looked at the history of Nazi propaganda, for example, and like how they only showed propaganda films in the night shows, about 10% of the time, and the rest of the time were happy films about whatever else. But the there have been people influencing other people's ideas for a long time, not always necessarily for their own benefit. Anyone else? Oh, internet? The internet?
No, a personal question, or from me. I was thinking about the introduction is where you're saying that how games can change the world, and I've been thinking about a lot of things in my own experience with games, and I feel very confidently that games have changed my confidence in a really positive way, because you get the constant repetition of a task, and then you start failing at that task, and then you start becoming better and better, and then you just realize that like life gives you different opportunities all the time as well, and you can just try stuff, and if it doesn't work, you can just try again later. But I also wanted to just ask about if you have seen any big differences between zero-sum real competitive games and more like casual games where the competition is just something that you add on in the end. Like the Buffalo game doesn't seem like it's a competitive game where the goal is to get the most amount of points.
Oh, it is.
Well,
I mean, you can play it with cutthroat people and they will totally play like,
But the design goal of the game doesn't seem like it's, okay, you have to get these points to be able to have fun. Whereas other games might say that if you don't get these things, you will just get destroyed by your opponents. And have you seen any differences between those types of games where the design philosophy is more based around the competitive nature of the game, or where the design philosophy is more based around people playing it having fun in some sort of social setting? And I also wanted to ask, is it possible to buy Monarch here now?
No. Unfortunately, you can't have Monarch because this is the only print. This is like a print. I have to take this to Essen. Like, this actually has to go to Essen as be the demo copy at Essen. But you could come to Essen, and after Essen, you can have it. I'm going to have to send a ship of Monarchs to Norway. All right, so your question is interesting. I come, I'm an artist, and I've done a lot of projects as an artist where, like, I have, personal, biographical, game-like things that have no end, and I have a computer-controlled board game that actually debuted in Bergen, Norway in 1998. It was this computer-controlled board game called, darn it, career moves. And you play as a woman working in a high-tech company, but, like, there's no end. So you go around and around, and then people started to make up their own endings because there was no get to here. People started, they're moving their pieces around, they're listening to these, and then there was no end, and that was kind of my, like, tongue-in-cheek, like, ha, ha, ha. But really, then play it. What was more interesting than my ha, ha, was that players started to say, oh, well, I'm going to win if I get to be CEO. And someone else would be like, no, I'm going to get win if I collect all these objects. And so people started negotiating a win state. And I thought that was really interesting. So I thought, oh, I like this. This is like kind of collaborative storytelling, except it's collaborative game mastery. But then some hardcore gamers would be like, that's not a game. There's no end. Da-da-da-da. Here's why. Da-da-da. So I can play in both spaces. And I realize some people really want the challenge and the win and the end. And that's fine. And so all of these games have that. And if you're playing with Buffalo had was at Indiecade a couple of years ago, and it was cutthroat. It was cutthroat. There were people who went through that whole deck like four times to oust each other. I mean, you can get a really not so nice group playing, and that's totally fine. The game adapts to a culture, which is actually interesting. And for cultural things, I mean, it's interesting, like this game, for example, Monarch. So you win, you become the queen, but there are a lot of ways that you can kind of outsmart your sisters, and there's multiple strategies. But what was interesting is, on Reddit, someone had posted like, oh, you know, no gamer's gonna play this game. Aren't you worried you're getting rid of a whole half of the audience? And I was like, you know, I think that probably most people are gonna play this game. At Gen Con, which is the big American version of Eschenspiel, it's like 65,000 people go to the conference, and it was number two game of the whole conference. And the booth was filled with men playing this game. So like all day, you know, like waiting in line to play this game. So I'm not so worried that people don't want to play. You know, I think that we're in a new place for new maybe models. And there's some competitive and cooperative things both going on. There are a couple co-op models. So I'm bringing a cooperative thing into my games, but I'm not letting it be the only thing. So I think it can adapt to different play styles a little bit, hopefully. Good, yeah, interesting. Design questions. Are we ready? Oh, here's another person.
So I might be digressing here, but have you ever, do you have any comments on how in like the 70s and 80s when video games started that they were usually toy makers, and that has kind of affected the stigma on how people view games and video games and maybe board games? I wondered if you had any comments on how that affects how people play games or your work or anything like that.
I have things to say on that. I'm trying to open up something here that I think would be of interest to you. I didn't talk about this in my talk, and I won't take a long time, but I think it's kind of interesting. This is for another talk to high school kids I did. One moment. Okay, la la la. Games, games, games. One sec. I want you to see these pictures. Oh, yeah. Yeah, here, this is fun. That's me. It's me as a child. Here I am, playing my Operation game. Here. I can't, oh. It seems to have crashed my computer, myself. Myself crashed it. So I'm looking at game culture here, right? So that's kind of what I'm doing. I mean, I think there's this weird perception right now that games have always been a masculine space. And that is just wrong, actually. Hold on. It's wrong. For example, the board game industry in the United States was started by a woman, Annie Abbott, who brought Mansion of Happiness to the world. And also, where's my slide on this? Hold on, I'm kind of stuck. I'm sharing you, share jitta. I can't show, I'm I have a really great set of advertising from Atari somewhere. I take pictures when I see old Atari boxes. Many of the Atari games were actually marketed as family games, right? So they were whole families, including a mom and a daughter playing Centipede at a not just Atari. I mean, we're talking any of the older machines. There were lots of different kinds of ways that games were marketed, and then the gaming magazines started having certain kinds of ads, but they had family ads, and then they had like guy ads with like Ms. Pac-Man being a pinup kind of creature, which was weird on a lot of levels. But in around 1980, what's the name? I can't. Who makes the Wii? I'm having a brain thing. Thank you. Nintendo published data that was about that women were 45% of the Nintendo purchasers in 1980. So I grew up playing console games. The other person I knew who played games was a girl. Like these console games were marketed to women. There was the arcade scene, which also inherited stuff from the pinball era. And pinball being on ships and navy, like this kind of at port, there's a kind of military and pinball scene, and also pachinko parlors in the East. So there's a history of that kind of stuff, but equal, there's a history of girls also learning to program in BASIC. And the guy who developed the BASIC computing programming language, Kemeny, taught his daughter to program when she was 12 years old in the 60s. So like there was a whole other kind of technological movement. So I think that I tend to talk about it like that there are many, many women and girls playing games and programming computers for that matter until about the rise of the first person shooter, weirdly. Playing networked Doom, I tended to be the only woman playing. I think that we are in a new era again, right? We have a lot of women inventing games as part of the indie game movement, and we also have a lot of female players. It's really, I mean, most data suggests it's about 50-50. So I think that I think it's back to where it was in 1980. So that's interesting and kind of fascinating from a historical perspective how we reinterpret a lot. I mean, Centipede was programmed by a woman and Portal was designed by a woman, and you know, we can just go on and on about the number of women who are involved in technological spaces as well. So I think we're back to where we started in terms of the mass commercialization of games in the late 70s, early 1980s.
Yeah, what's your opinion on tutorials, especially in-game tutorials, considering they've become more and more restrictive during the past 15 to 20 years? Games in the 80s, as far as I've experienced at least, were really open to begin with. You had to figure out everything by yourself. Then came games like, I don't know, Thief perhaps, and such, which had more closed tutorials. Would you consider in-game restrictive tutorials to have an impact upon learning, perhaps problem solving and such?
I could not begin to guess at the impact of tutorials on learning, because we don't know what learning's happening anyway. So we don't know what's going on, really. It's good to not, if we don't know, we should just not know. But I think that we're making more complex games. So in some ways, probably tutorials are useful on certain levels. I don't think tutorials are needed on the kinds of levels that I'm at. So I'm good with that. All right. Thank you so much, everyone. I think we're done, unless we have the internet. No? Thank you. I'm gonna